Hey, praise the Lord. It's Pastor Jim here. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. It's good to have you come and join us. If you have any comments or any prayer requests, please feel free to put them up on that little board there. Right now, I'm going to ask for my sister Jackie, who has come to visit, staying at a nice social distance, and somebody else just came in too at a nice social distance. Thank you. I'm going to ask her to come and pray for us.
Thank you, Jesus. God, we praise you, Lord. Yes. Father, we worship you, O Lord Jesus. I praise you. I'm grateful, God, that you allow me to be here today, God. I thank you, Father God, for this day, Lord Jesus. And I pray, Father God, that you, God, take full control of this service, Lord Jesus, God. That you, God, use Pastor Jim in a mighty and powerful way, God, yes, to get, God, your word across into our hearts, Lord Jesus. We praise you. We thank you, God. We pray, yes, God, for each and every one, God, battling, God, this coronavirus, Lord Jesus. Father, you see the hospitals. You see the staff, God. You see the patients, Lord Jesus. Father, but you are able, Lord Jesus. There is no limits with you, no impossibles, God. We pray, Lord Jesus, that you, God, use your mighty and powerful healing hands, God, over each and every one, God. In your name, Lord, we surrender this service to you, Jesus. We bless your name. We thank you, God. Let it be, God, for your honor and glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. I can hear you clapping out there on your couches with a cup of coffee. Somebody save you some. Amen. Let's just praise the Lord today. Father, we thank you, Lord.
Thank
you, Lord, for that prayer, Lord. And we just pray for the worship now, Lord, that it would just be, it would be a blessing to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Your love never fails.
Thank you, Lord.
love never fails, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.
We want to just concentrate on your Holy Spirit today, Lord God. On the Spirit of the living God. If that was the next song, but it's not.
All you want kisses, coming after me. This is the air.
worship you, Lord. Give you glory and honor, Father. Worthy, worthy, worthy.
Be over.
Praise the Lord. It's good to be in the house of the Lord today. A few people have come in. We are at safe distance. I would say 19 feet apart. And it's so good to have you on. Agustin, it's good to see you guys. And Kathleen, it's good to have you on. Praise the Lord. Let me just get my... There you go, right there. That's it. We usually have to adjust our camera afterwards to make sure that we can... Let me just get my computer to do what I need it to do. Screen brightness and auto lock, never here. And here we are. Thank you, Jesus. We thank you for your love and for your mercy, for your precious Holy Spirit. In this place, we thank you, Jesus. We thank you for all that you've done for us, Lord God. Father in heaven, we thank you for this morning, Lord, and pray that you will be with us, that you will enlighten us, Lord. Enlighten our hearts, our minds, our souls, our spirits, Lord God. And even though we are apart, it's the apart now that keeps us close. It's the apart now that's keeping us safe. And Father, we can still connect this way. I see the hearts. I see the names. I love seeing people that knew how. Leanne, if I mention your name as I start preaching, if I just say your name quickly, I'm saying hello and trying to stay in track on my mind. So I want you to understand that. Thank you so much. If you have a prayer request, I want you to put it down and put it on citylimitsag@msn.com. That should come on your screen in a few minutes, and you should be able to see that, or go to our City Limits Facebook website, and you can see our City Limits Facebook site, and you'll be able to see it there. Please put your prayer request down or put them here, and I'll make sure that that me and or one of the other staff people are going to get in contact with you and pray for you, pray for your need, and pray for the world and for whatever is going on in your life and in your heart. Hi, Leanne. Somebody just said hello. Denise, my cousin from New Jersey, is watching. Thank you. I'm so glad that my Uncle Tony is okay. Pray for your family. Pray that yous are all doing okay. Hey, my scripture this morning is found in the book of Acts, chapter 1 and verse 8. But you shall receive power when the Holy Ghost comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, then unto the uttermost parts of the earth. My Jerusalem is right here, is right here and right here. All these people who hear me and all the people in this room, in this city, my home, my house, all the people that I influence, all the people that are in my sphere of influence. You know, my title for today is to be filled with the Spirit. How do you adjust to the wind of the Spirit is my theme that I'm going to be going on. On several occasions, I've heard it said in the Bible that we are to be filled with the Spirit. And sometimes I need to ask myself, what exactly does that mean to be filled with the Spirit? To be filled with the Spirit, how? You know, to be filled with the Spirit all the time, to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, to be speaking in tongues, to be what? What does it mean to be filled with the Spirit? You know, and I want to use a couple of illustrations. Something that came to me was, you know, I love history. I love seeing history. I absolutely love it. I love to see all the battles when England came over here, and Britons came over here, and they conquered America, or tried to conquer America. America fought back, and the ships and everything, and how long it took the colonies to come down. It took them sometimes 3 to 6 months until the ships finally came forward. And something I noticed was that at that time, there was no propane, there was no gas, there was no fuel, there was no rocket fuel, there was no jet propulsion, there was no motors, there was no steam at that time. It still wasn't invented. All they had was wind. They had sailboats and they had wind. And as I took a look at that, I thought, there was a time in America, there was a time in history when there was no energy source other than the wind, other than the air. And by the wind and by the air is how you were moved from location to destination or to whatever you were going to. So how do you sail old ships if you didn't have wind? If you didn't have wind, it was called a dead stall, a dead stop. They would just pull all the sails down, and they would wait. Sometimes they would wait. Sometimes they would almost starve. They would fish. They would thirst for water. They would run out of water because they were just in a calm, because there was no wind in sight. No wind in sight, and they'd be worried, and they couldn't do anything. Something else I learned, and you probably think, well, Pastor Jim's from North Philly. He's not a sailor. Where did he learn this from? Well, you go on YouTube and you watch a whole lot and read a whole lot and you find out a whole lot. So what I did was I thought, what do boats do when they come into a battle? You come into a battle and here's these two ships coming and they've got their sails up and they're coming right across each other. They usually lower their sails because that's what's going to propel them, and they need to protect them. So they lower their sails and they bring them down so that when they fire at each other, they can damage other things, but don't damage their chances of getting away or of moving forward. In the book of Acts, chapter 1 and verse 8, to move in the direction of the wind blowing is not our job. Our job is to determine how the wind is blowing and how to adjust our sails so we can go where the Lord wants us to go. Are you following me? And I think that so many people, we get so used to, when they came out of dock, you would think if a big ship is in England and it's coming out of dock, how would it get out if there was no wind there? I mean, it's in a little bay or something like that. They would row. It would be manpower. They'd have people under deck and they'd have them chained together, slaves, and they would row that ship out. And that's how they would move when they had no wind. Are you following me? They would move on flesh power. Keep that in mind. Keep that in mind. So as we enter this message, I want to talk to you about four practical ways that we can adjust our sails every day. I tried to do a little study yesterday on sails. On the main sail, on the jib, on the bottom sail, on the small sail that goes on the front of boats that we don't know what they are. The big giant sail is for mild winds. It catches mild winds and it pushes your boat along. The very small sail at the front, or sometimes it's a bubble sail, right? That thing is for real hard winds. When there's hard winds, it'll just catch your boat and start pushing it out there. Right? And there's so many things. There's a sail in the back. That one is to control how you go and how you lean. Because I can actually go right into the wind with my sailboat. And somebody would say, well, how can I go into the wind if I have my sail up? If I just put my sail just a little bit, it'll pinch it. And like a grape, it'll push my boat out. Even though I'm going into the wind. So I hope I've impressed you with my sailing skills. I'm actually a kayaker. And the most I've done with sails is take my wet t-shirt off and put it up in the air between two arms so the wind could blow me when my arms got tired of paddling, okay? But so what are four ways that we could use that we could move in the Spirit, that we could be led by the Spirit, I could be caught in the Spirit? And the first one that I want to give you is I got to surrender control. Put that down someplace in your Bible. I've got to surrender control. And I mean complete. To be filled with the Spirit starts with a loss of my control. And that's something that we are so used to doing things and making things and fixing things and calling people and getting things done. I'll do it myself. I don't need your help. We're so used to getting things done that before we call on God, we'll try to do things in the flesh. But if you want to be filled with the Spirit and pray without ceasing, you've got to surrender control and understand that my life now lived is a life of Christ, and living in Christ, I've got to surrender to what He wants me to do on a daily basis. Complete surrender of self. Surrender control is to admit that our ship, our boat, our person, our life, we got to stop trying to do things in the flesh that God is obviously convicting us of in the Spirit. And you know when something is in your heart and it's saying, don't do that. Nah, it's not a good idea. You shouldn't do it. You know when that's happening to you. That's the Holy Spirit convincing you, convicting you. This is not the way to go. And he's trying to tell you, I showed you the way to go, and you're still trying to paddle with the oars. You're still trying to go in the flesh, and I need you. I need you to be obedient. Put the sail up and go where my spirit is trying to take you. May not be where you thought you'd go. May not be where you wanted to go, but it sure will be God's will for you. A person's got to stop trying in the flesh. I cannot move in my own strength. I got to wait for the wind of the Holy Spirit. And then I've got to adjust my sails to God's purpose and to the direction of God. But stop in my own strength. Stop trying in my own flesh. In my own flesh, I'll tell you something. There are drugs we take today. There are medications we take today. There is smoking pot today. There's all these things. I want you to know something I learned. And because I was an addict for, 100 years, and just impulse. There's dopamine that comes into your mind, and that dopamine makes you feel good. And so we do impulse things. When you start getting high or do things, you'll do things out of impulse. Sometimes very bad things that could cause you a lot of shame and pain in life. And you need to understand that these things are of the devil to get you to stop thinking clearly. My life belongs to the Lord. If I need to be filled with anything, let me be filled with the Spirit of God. So when God calls us, the first thing that he may do to get you to surrender control, buckle up, is going to be to repent. To repent of something that you've been doing. To repent of things that have been going in your life. To repent of things that you've been thinking. To repent of secret things. Now listen, sometimes things come into our mind that doesn't mean it reached our heart and we did not do it. It's just a bad thought. It just passed through. Right? And we just surrender that up to God. But sometimes if we play with things, if we're playing with them and massaging them and toying around with things or dipping and dabbing or here and there, then you got to know it's time to repent and say, I surrender all my control to the Holy Spirit, to the will of God, to the walk of God, and to what the Lord wants me to do and not to myself. I got to yield myself. Yield is to yield. It's not just to, I've seen people yield. I've seen signs. Yeah, come on. Traffic has got a yield sign. They just come right in. Yield don't mean that. Yield means that I come and I slow down and I see what traffic is coming. And when I see a way in, I get in. And we sometimes are so crazy. We just jump into things. That's impulse. Our impulse, we're letting our lives be driven by our emotions. We must live by faith, not by how we feel. We must live by the promises of God, not by the things that make us feel a certain way here and there. I can wake up, listen, I woke up early this morning, my body hurt, my knees ached, but I knew Jesus still loved me. I know I'm still a child of God, and I know I'm saved. And no pain, nothing in my body could take away the fact and the promise that I am saved. I want to come under the influence of the Holy Spirit. I want you to take this out. Nothing says it clearer than Paul. Paul says this in Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. Thank you for all the hearts and everything. I love it. Brother Ray, it's good to see you, man. It's good to see you guys. Carmen Acevedo, good to see you. Nuha, God bless you all. Galatians chapter 2, verse 20 says this. Here's how Paul demonstrates how he surrendered. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live. That's surrender. But Christ lives in me. The life I now live in this body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself up for me. Are you following me? He's saying, I've been crucified. I died with Jesus. Now look, I know the flesh is going to fight every day. And you and I got a battle every day. We got a battle every day. And you know when you're trying to do things right for the Lord, you know the devil's going to be right at your door. He's going to be right at your doorstep trying to make you do things wrong. And that's when you got to put on the power of God. Put on the baptism. You got to pray more because that, listen, when you make a decision to turn to God and surrender your life to the Holy Spirit, that's when the devil's going to come in like a rushing wind and try to knock you down, disturb you, and distract your mind. Make you lose faith. So what do we do while we're waiting? Sometimes it seems like in this COVID that the wind has stopped. I don't have any wind in my big sail. I don't have a gushing wind in my small sail. I'm not supposed to get into the flesh and try to work it out on my own. Maybe God's got me waiting on him. So what do while we're waiting? Number two, saturate your soul with the word. Wash yourself with the word. Wash yourself, saturate yourself in the word of God. My wife and I get up every morning and we do a verse 15. We also do some other reading in the Bible. Also read Jesus Calling. Also pray a little bit for our kids. If maybe a grandchild comes in the room, we'll sit them with us and pray with them and talk with them and talk with them about the Lord. And I try to bring a grandchild every week with me. Today, Sarai is here with me. And why? Because our children are watching us. And while I'm stalemated here, waiting on what is going to happen, I've got to keep talking about Jesus. I've got to keep talking about the cross. I've got to keep setting an example. I've got to continue being a model. I can't fold in half and start getting high and think that life is over. I got to say, Jesus, you must have allowed this to happen for some reason. And so I am going to be ready to serve you. I'm waiting on your orders, God. While I'm doing that, let me saturate myself in the word. Let me saturate. Imagine a sponge is dry and you stick a sponge in a bucket and you sink it to the bottom and you bring that sponge out. If you were to shake that sponge, it'd be like a dog. There'd be water going. That's what I mean by saturate, where you're soaking in the word of God. Times like these are times of distraction that'll get us, I don't have time for that. Just read something in the Word every day. Read something in the Word. Pray, say, God, open my heart. Show me how this applies to me. Read something in the Word and start doing it. Make it a habit and create a habit until you're praying every day and doing it, until it becomes a lifestyle. Until it becomes, hey, this is what we do. This is how we live. I heard somebody say, this is what we do. This is how we live. We pray every day. Oh, hallelujah. God's word is active and living. It cuts through bone. It cuts through sinew, muscle. It comes through bad attitude. It cuts through everything. God's word pierces. God, listen, Hebrews 4:12 says, God's word knows the thoughts and intents of your heart. If the thoughts and intents of my heart have been going left or right or not following God, maybe I need to get into the word and the word will straighten me out and show me the way that God wants me to go. Or be still till he sends the wind. Speaking of sails, of the direction of our sails, the third one, after I saturate, I'm just soaking in. Number three is to dialogue. Dialogue. Talk to God. Dialogue. Big word. Talk to God each day, all day. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you. Oh, look at them kids playing. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Man, that food was good. Thank you, Lord. Man, that food, it wasn't too good today, but you know, there's some kids that ain't got no food. So thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Fine. Turn everything the devil tries to turn negative into a positive. Man, my knee's hurting today. There's some people in wheelchairs that'll never walk again for the rest of their life. Thank you, Lord, for a little bit of pain. I can take it. Thank you, Lord. But listen to me. Dialogue with God throughout the day. John chapter 3, verse 8 says this: for the wind blows wherever it pleases, and you hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. We hear the wind. We have to be patient, saturated in God, waiting on God to see this is where God wants me to go. Some people tell me, Pastor Jim, I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do. I'm confused. That's the devil doing that. You think of the last thing God told you to do and do it, and you'll be back on track. I'm telling you, you remember back the last thing God said and do that, and you'll be back in line. Come on, somebody, say amen. Adjusting our sails, man. Adjusting our sails. In this time of COVID, it may seem that, you know, man, we need to remain vigilant. It may seem that things are going out of whack. It may seem that the wind is not blowing. It may seem that we've been forced to stop. But even in this time, we've got to be diligent. Diligent means that, you know, I've got to make it a habit. I've got to do this no matter what. I got to get up. I got to get on my knees. If my knees hurt, then I stand in the corner and pray now. What I do, but I need to be diligent with my habits. I need to create a, don't let this time make you become lazy. My goodness, I know I don't have corona. Look at this. I've been wearing my mask so I'll stay out of the refrigerator. In the house, I think everybody ought to wear them in the house to stay out their refrigerator, stay out that kitchen. And you can laugh at that or not, but just admit it. All of y'all gang, well, just, I'll see you when you get back. I'll be spreading the chairs out. The Holy Spirit is constantly moving, and we need to dialogue, man, with God. Paul says in 1 Thessalonians 5:7, pray without ceasing. Don't stop, man. Don't stop it. People say, how can I pray while I'm driving? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Another pretty day. Thank you, Jesus. That car. Thank you, Jesus. That guy. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Some people ain't got a car. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I let somebody in my car, they fill my tank. Thank you, Lord. Man, I let the kids in my car, they cleaned it out today. Thank you, Lord. Just find things to thank the Lord for. Work on having discipline now in your life. Don't take this time to be lazy and take a staycation, a stay-home vacation. You got to be aware of God's presence in your home, at work, at Walmart, on the couch, and everywhere in between. You find that the Holy Spirit wind blows in every place, in every way, even a small one. I always keep my big sail up just in case there's just a mild wind. He might be saying, just go this way a little bit. I need you to go that way a little bit, Jimmy. You're just off track, just a little bit. Migdalia, it's good to see you. So here, I want to share this with you. So I surrender myself. I saturate my soul. I meditate on the promises of God. And finally, non-negotiable. The other three will not work if you don't do this one. You've got to obey. You've got to, listen to me, you've got to obey. The Holy Spirit doesn't speak to us for our amusement because he wants to impress us. There's always a reason. There's a purpose. There's a direction. There's a call. There's something to be done. The Holy Spirit, it doesn't just speak to me, oh, he's my friend. We just rap about stuff. The Holy Spirit, when the Holy Spirit talks to you, there's something to be done. Something's got to change. Something's got to move. Something's got to be done. He wants you to help that person. He wants you to stop judging that person and help that person. He wants you to do something, and we need to be available for that. Let me give you a biblical illustration. In the book of Acts, chapter 16, Paul is going to go from Asia to Europe. And there were moments in this chapter, chapter 16, if you want to read it on your own as a devotional, that changed history. Because Paul wanted to go someplace, and it says, and the Holy Spirit bid him not to go there. You say, wow. Man, when the whole, man, now listen. Sometimes I've been there. I confess to you, Not now, but as a younger man, I was so involved and like, let me go talk to the gangsters. Let me go go in the middle of them and just talk to them about Jesus. I'll go to anybody. A lot of it was just Jimmy doing what Jimmy thought he could do. But it was not led by the Holy Spirit because it never bore fruit. And so Paul is going to these places and the Holy Spirit is saying, I bid, do not go there. Go here. Do not go there. Go here. Do not go there. Go here. And then one night in a dream, he gets the Macedonian call. He gets a call from a man of Macedonia saying, come, come and minister to us Gentiles. Come and minister. And then he goes. Are you following me? Sometimes we need to obey. Obedience is the big thing when we hear God say no about something. If you feel something is negative, is bad, that's a no. That's not like, I wonder why I'm having that feeling. That means no. Come on now. Those moments changed the world, changed our history. If you're not sure, the safest way to get back on track, if you've been distracted by COVID-19, by this world, by all the commercials, all the YouTube, all the Netflix and everything, take some time to meditate and soak in God's word and say, God, what did you tell me last? I told you to serve here. That's what you're supposed to be doing. That's it. You let yourself get confused. All that wind's been dragging you all over the place. So my conclusion, I surrender control and I'm back in God's will. Saturate myself in the word and I begin to understand things that are true and things that are lies. Dialoguing with God throughout the day, talking with God, keeping an open communication. That means talking. Dialogue means speaking. And dialogue also means listening. Means shutting up and listening. You should probably wear your mask for that. Obey. By obedience is to obey the promptings of the Holy Spirit. I'm asking you to be obedient to the promptings of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is calling to us. Let's be obedient to the promptings of the Holy Spirit. I want to share something with you. Yeah, then I've made there's time to pray. I want to share a story with you that has been shared for many, many years, but maybe you've not heard it. And maybe it's time that you hear it, because when I heard it a long time ago, it just made me feel like, wow. I'll share the story and you'll see. You can tell me by your hearts or your amens or hallelujahs. There was a boy who painstakingly, and that means hard, very difficult, he built a model sailboat. He had spent so many days and weeks in building it. It was finally complete, and he decided that he would test it out by taking it to the open water close to where he lived. So the boy loved the boat. He was proud of the boat. He even put his initials on the boat. So he went down to the water. First, he made sure all the sails were just right so they could catch the wind and move. He made sure his sails were just right, up and just right. Then excitedly, he placed the boat in the water and he gave it a little push, just a little push. He gave it a little push. And what a sight. It started to skim across the water, cut right through the water. Man, it was catching the wind. It was just gone. But then something really unexpectedly happened. Before the boy realized it, he took a look at what was happening. His boat was getting way far out of the way. It was going and going. He jumped in the water and realized, oh man, I can't go anymore. It's too deep and the boat is way out. Finally, his boat was missing. It was gone. He went home. He started crying. He said, Mom, I spent all this time on this boat. I put this on there. I didn't know how to turn it around. I set the sails and it just went. His mom said, I'm sorry, maybe you could build another. No, I'm not going to build another one. I spent so much time on that one. I loved it so much. Buckle up. A few weeks later, he's walking through town, his little town. He sees a little secondhand shop, and in the window is his boat. He runs in, he grabs the boat. He grabs the boat and he says that to the guy at the counter, this is mine, this is mine. He starts to walk out the door and the man says, yo, yo, son, that's not your boat, that's my boat. He says, no, it's my boat. Look, I got my initials on it. He said, that's my boat. I bought that boat from someone. That boat is my boat. And if you want it, you're going to have to pay for it. So the little boy, having no money, he goes home. He starts talking to his mom, other people. He makes a little bit of money, nickels, dimes, quarters. He saves enough to go buy the boat for a couple of bucks. A small amount. And something happened. This poor little boy, he finally goes back in. And he purchases the boat. And the man says, here, now it's your boat. And he looks at his little initials he had scratched on there. He took the boat. And as he was leaving, this is important. As he was leaving, as he was carrying his boat away, he held it close to his chest. He says, now you're mine twice. First on the day I made you, and now on the day I bought you. Are you following me tonight? I'm sorry, this morning. Are you following me I've been made. We are like sailboats. Something I found out about sailing. Shipping is different. You can control it. You're there. You can control it. The sailboats. Now, I'm not talking about ships that have a big thing in a rudder. Only sailboats. They have to be managed. You got a rig and you pull in the rig and then you tighten it up and you taut it. And then the wind changes and you move the rig to the other side and you change it so you can keep going in a direction. Needs constant maintenance. You've got to be involved in what is going on with the Holy Spirit. And I think that some of us, oh, Jesus, please help me. I'm trying to get this right. I think some of us think, well, as long as I pray and I'm open to the Holy Spirit, that's it. I'll just go. No. You've still got some responsibility and choice. You can turn and not turn. You've still got to manage and pull the rig in and pull the sail down and pull the sails down because it's blowing too hard. Put the small sail up because you got a fast wind and follow. We've got to be involved in what is going on. And I think that some of us have lost that confidence in the Holy Spirit because we have relied on him. Then we just go off and we get lost. Like that little boy's boat just got lost. And we're like, well, I'm not doing this anymore. I'm just getting lost. And we don't realize sailboats are not a ship. They don't work with a you know what I mean? I've got this big old wheel and I can turn it any way I want. In a sailboat, you've got to be involved. And this is from the Holy Spirit. Right now, it's not on my note. So if you want to be involved in the Holy Spirit, if you want to be courageous and be filled with the Holy Spirit, be led by the Holy Spirit, be saturated by his word, surrender completely, you've got to admit also that you've got to be involved in that work. It's an effort. It's a discipline. It takes every day. I'm moving. I'm bringing in the sail. I'm moving. Where do you want me to go? Sometimes I pull it down and stay still and say, God, I'm not sure. Where do you want me to go? And then God will speak to you. When you're silent, God will speak to you. You put your sail back up and you start doing what God told you to do. City Limits. My message for today is that the Holy Spirit, in the midst of COVID-19, is still blowing and blowing hard. My question is, are you ready to participate in the direction that God is taking us? Right now, I want you to take a moment. I want to make this a part of our weekly time. You know, I want to take some time out. If you've got a prayer request, I want you to put it up there. Lissette, it's good to see you. For Nuha, I just want you to know, Father in heaven, I always pray for your country. I know that out in the Middle East, there's some horrible things happen. In the Middle East, yesterday, four men got dressed as police officers and went in and killed 24 people in a hospital that was trying to take care of COVID-19 people. They just killed them. And so, please, if you've got a prayer, let's just take a few moments and pray, please. Get involved. Thank you, Jesus. Father in heaven, I pray that you will be with us, that you will give us a wonderful day. Lord, there's so many out there that there's a myriad. There's a bunch. There's just a bunch of different things to pray about. But you help us today, Lord God, to saturate in your word, to pray without ceasing. When something's wrong, say, thank you, God. I got legs. I can walk. Somebody's walking across slow and they've got a walker. You say, wow, man, I've got to wait an extra 3 minutes and the light is green. Say, thank you, Lord, that I can walk and I have a car. If your tank is full and you've got $10 and the gas thing in your thing, you see somebody down there, put your mask on, get out, go fill the tank and give it to them. Just give it to them. God will give you another one. If God wants you to keep doing that, God will just give you another gas tank. It's happened to me. I've got 4 or 5 at home. Hey, church, Father in heaven, I thank you for this day. 10:30 to 11:30 is not too bad. So I pray that you will just spend some time today in prayer. Pray for your children. And now it's time to receive the Lord's tithe and offering. I used to say I symbolically raised this, but there's a few people that have been doing their tithe and offering here at church. I'm not saying that there's a lot of that we've opened. I'm just saying that we are scattered, I don't know, 18 feet away, 7 feet away, 6 feet away, some more or less, without lying. If you're family, it's okay to sit close. Okay? So, Father, we thank you for this tithe and offering. If you are a visitor out there or you're a guest, and you'd like to give to City Limits Assembly of God Ministry in Allentown, Pennsylvania, there is a textable number. What textable means is that if you go to our Facebook site, there's a number there and it tells you how to text. If you text $10, it's $10, $15, or whatever you want to text. And it's a once and done. It's not a recurring thing. If you don't trust texting, and some people don't, you know, people are getting hacked and some people don't. Ours is good, but some people don't, and we've been using ours for 5 years, 6 years. If you don't, it's okay to send a check to 302, that's on Ridge Avenue. Somebody could please put that on the screen for me, 302, and that's on Ridge Avenue, Allentown, Pennsylvania, 18102. City Limits Assembly of God, 302 on Ridge Avenue, Allentown, Pennsylvania, 18102. Thank you very much. Father in heaven, now bless this offering, Lord, for your work and for your purpose. We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. Lord. And thank you for the people that have already given an offering. Hey, so sail on. I'd say if you've just been like in a light drift in the same place, stuck in the same place, put your sail up. Put your sail up. Ask the Lord where he's trying to take you. And I want you to know that I love you so much. And I miss you. Man, I've not heard a whole lot from you. I'd love to hear from you. As I said last week, I'm still waiting on a couple of emails. PastorJim@RCN.com, all lowercase. PastorJim@RCN.com. And I'd like to take a 6 to 9 foot prayer walk with you down on Sand Island. I get a couple of protein bars. I know I said candy bars last week. I meant a protein bar. And we'll wear our masks and wear some gloves. I've got a box of gloves. I've got some extra masks. So if you'd like to go on just a prayer walk, so we can fellowship, see each other's face, say hi from a distance, give each other a little high five or something, okay? God bless you all. You have a great and a wonderful day. Father in heaven, I pray that the peace of God that passes all understanding would guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. I continually pray again, Lord, for Wilma, Lord, and for Charlie, and for my friends out there that are suffering, Lord, that are hurting in body, Lord God, and for Karen Tersey, Lord, in her lungs, Lord. And I just pray that you would just be with all our friends. There's a lady in Florida, Lord, and she too, Lord, needs prayer. I pray for my friend that's in the Bronx that has been writing me letters. Thank you so much. It feels so good to be encouraged from another state, Lord. And I thank you for all of you and pray God's blessing on you and his peace. Have a great, wonderful Sunday. Enjoy a beautiful day. In Jesus' name, Pastor Jim out. Amen. Amen.